this is our annual meeting, and so first order of business is to reorganize ourselves. Trying to sound like we're disorganized, but we're so much turn over to you, I guess, just to get this started.
Thank you.
Carrie?
Nominations for chair.
Nominate David Sharp.
Second. First and second. All in favor?
Any
other nominations? I need this. We're closing nominations. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Don't accept, sure.
Fine. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Okay, and then we need a vice chairman of the committee, so I'll accept any nominations for the vice chair.
Second.
Any other nominations? No? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so pending his acceptance. Vice chair. We also need a secretary.
I'll nominate Jan Vlaska.
Okay.
Right.
I'll second that. Any other nominations? All in favor of Jan, secretary?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. We also need a representative to the Frontier School Board.
Okay. I nominate Mary Raymond.
Okay. Second. Anyone else interested? No? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Now, we also have, let's see, our Union 38 representatives. I guess we need to nominate all those, or ask the people who want to. I'm not sure if they're nominated or just some people want to do it. I think those are appointed. So I'm going to appoint whoever wants to do it. You'd like to do it? Okay. I'd be happy to do it, and so would Ken. So, the collaborative. Yeah, you've done yeoman's work there.
Did you enjoy it?
Yep. Yeah.
5,000 miles away, you've been to some of those meetings, okay.
Well, they're off of this over too, right?
Webcast.
Okay, so Jan, thank you for doing that. And I'll also appoint Ken, pending his acceptance to the Capital Improvements Planning Committee. Okay.
Welcome, Chair.
2 minutes.
2 minutes?
You did a lot of action pending your acceptance of being Vice Chair.
So. Oh, goodness. Certainly.
Okay, thank you. And you're also on the Union 38 Committee, and you're also on the Capital Improvements Committee, if that's okay?
Okay. Perfect. Sorry.
No? Okay. So let's look at the minutes from May 3rd. Anybody have any comments, edits?
The only thing I was going to amend was under public comment, we had a discussion about better communication, but I noticed at the end of the meeting, end of the minutes, we also noted that, so. Amendment to that.
So you want to make an amendment?
No, I just wanted to point out that it was under public comment.
Oh, the, okay. So it's mentioned in the minutes near the end.
It is mentioned.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So motion to approve the minutes.
Motion to approve the minutes. May 3rd, 2017.
Second. Okay. All in
favor? Aye.
Aye. Thank you. And Eddie, let's turn it over to you for a financial statement.
Okay, so three things tonight. First, we have eight warrants to sign, totaling $155,615.65. And before I talk about the monthly expense report, I'd like to review our lunch program with you, which is on the legal sheets. And I want to begin by telling you that we had our two-year DESE review, and we did have to do some corrective action plans. Two of them were around the free and reduced lunch application process. We did not perform the direct certification properly, nor did we meet the deadline of verifying our applications. The reason that these two, we were deficient in these areas, was because this was a new system doing direct cert. So most of our certifications now, we go online and we have to do that three times, and we didn't do it timely enough, nor did we complete the verification. It was just a little bit disorganized this year. Unfortunately, it resulted in the examiner finding 9 students whose status should have been changed, and because they weren't, we have to pay back some money. And it's based on a formula, a percent of error, and extrapolated. It's not a dollar for dollar. So we're going to be assessed $3,953.50 that we're going to, the state is going to take back from our program. Our corrective action plan regarding these items is that we all, everyone in the district who's involved in this process, is going to be attending a webinar put on by DESE. We're going to have a written procedure book, and we're going to have calendar. We're going to have calendar alerts. I'll have calendar alerts so that I make sure that each school has completed these tests on time.
These were 9 students that maybe should have had the opportunity for free lunch.
Opposite. They were designated free, and they should not have.
Oh, they should not have been. Okay.
Correct. The other areas that we were cited for is that our school committee does not have a charging policy in place or one that they implement. The school committee's wellness policy is not updated. We will be bringing to you in the fall a charging policy, and Dr. Carey has put together the wellness committee, and they'll be meeting over the summer to update our wellness policy, and we'll be bringing that to you sometime in the fall for your approval.
What's the charging policy?
So when people don't pay their bills, we would set a limit that once they reach $10, $20, that the student does not receive a full hot meal. They would receive a substitute meal, which would be the sandwich of the day. And that's what the state is looking for us to do, because we now, with the law, we as a school committee have to pay that bill that the parents don't pay at the end of the year, so that the school lunch balance is not in deficit. So it's public funds that we're using to pay that debt. So they expect that we have a charging policy and that we implement it, so that we're using the least amount of public monies to subsidize parents that don't pay for lunch.
Is there another avenue to do that? Another avenue to have, another way that we can pay? I mean, I'm hesitant to have kids not have a hot lunch.
Well, we can continue to get written up.
Right. Okay.
See, that's the problem, Trevor, is we don't do it.
Right.
And they're saying, you have to do it. And I tell them my school committee doesn't want to do it.
But there's no financial consequence for that, right?
Well, there is, because you're taking money out of your budget and putting it into
right,
school
to pay off the difference.
Correct.
Yeah.
But we're not talking hundreds of kids here. We're talking...
Well, we'll get to it right now. We're owed $1,700 for parents right now.
We are.
And that's not everybody. That's just our large O's.
Mm-hmm.
So the other thing that everybody got written up for with the charging policy and the wellness is that we're supposed to advertise our participation in a local newspaper. So for that one, I am talking with all the business managers in Franklin County to see if we can do a joint ad and share the cost of that, mm-hmm. so that we don't have to do it for each school or even just our district. And then we had 2 minor kitchen infractions. We were missing our dishwasher temp, so not really. We just got to make sure that the where we mark our temperatures is in a spot that anyone can come in and view. So that was the DESE review, and what I've given you tonight is our profit and loss. Right now, through May, our loss is $4,588.24. When we add the money they're going to take back, the $3,953.50, our deficit is $8,541.74. And as I stated, right now our outstanding balances are about $1,700.
Can I just ask a question? You said this is a DESE audit that was done?
we every 2 years we have to have an administrative review of our procedures. Mm-hmm.
So DESE decides on a $3,000 penalty, and it doesn't go back to the state, since it's all federal sources that it's charging against?
We've already received it. They have to take it back from us. What they do with it, I don't know.
The federal government takes it back, or the state?
The state does, because all this money comes through the state.
Okay. But it's federal.
It is federal money. That's both, just like Title I. The money is given from the feds to the state to us.
Okay.
So now we have to give it back.
It cost $3,000 to do the audit.
So the second page is our statistics, and things are, I think, looking up, because when I look at our participation through 10 months in 16, our participation was 46.2%, and right now we're at almost 54%. So our participation is up. We're going to be actually serving almost 3,000 more lunches this year than we did last year. So things are turning around. Kids are eating our lunches, and that's a good thing. So now we talk about where we're going to be at the end of the year. So we're going to have to cover the $1,700 bed debt and the $8,500 loss in the kitchen. And then we have some others. So right now, I'm estimating that we will have approximately a little over $50,000 at year end. And I did have conversations with Janine and with Bob Lesko. And with those available funds, we would like your permission to do as many of these on the list as we can once the final accounting is done. And the priorities would be adding some Chromebook carts to the school for a total of $2,000. Doing the window tint that we had previously issued, we haven't done that. It's a summer project, but you had given us permission to use school choice funds. The funds are available here, so we would rather use $4,500 from the budget rather than the school choice to get the window tinting done. We'd like to do the clocks and controllers, which would be about $10,000. Doing some sidewalk paving in the back of the school and painting the parking lot lines. Mr. Lesko would like us to clear out a drainage swale. And replace the water pressure valve here in the building and start working on replacing some of the smoke detectors. And that comes up to about $51,800 in projects, and I'm estimating $50,522, so we're right in about the same ballpark. So with your permission, those would be our spending priorities as money is available at the end of the year.
Okay.
Can we back up for a couple of questions? So with the 1,700 and the 8,541, that's like 10,000 something. Where does that come out of?
That'll be the first thing. Any available funds we have, unspent funds at the end of the year, that'll be the first thing we have to take care of.
Unrelated to school lunch, you're talking about general funds that are.
We're going to use general funds to supplement the school lunch deficit and outstanding debt.
Got it. Okay, thank you.
And still trying to track down some of that 1,600, 1,700 for bed.
Yeah, but what happens?
I understand. You have to get it. No.
It has to go back to the general fund if we recoup it after the fact.
Any other questions about this?
So I know we had authorized the clocks and the window tinting a while back. We just hadn't. And that we are going to do with school choice funds.
Correct. And what we're recommending is leaving our school choice funds in school choice and using available funds from this budget if they're available.
Do we know what we'll have left over for school choice funds?
No, I don't have a projection at this time. If you look at the report that I sent you, right now we're running about $122,000 to the good from what we projected we would spend. So if we add, we're going to have $138,000 approximately more than we anticipated, and we don't have our final accounting yet either from the state. That'll come in late June.
Yeah. Okay. So. question, Mary?
Yeah, I just have one more question about the wellness policy.
Mm-hmm.
We never had one?
We do, it needs to be updated.
Oh, we just haven't updated it. Okay, that's what I thought.
It's outdated.
We're putting together the committee with the nurse leader. For our administrator, we're having the principal of Conlon and any other administrator who wants to join. And we will be meeting this summer to go through our wellness policy and update everything. And we will be looking for volunteers to join.
And we have just updated a bunch of our policies. This is one that we probably just didn't spend a ton of time on.
It's a little bit different than the school committee policies
gotcha.
That we did.
Okay.
I think it is a school committee, but it's also a standalone one.
Yeah.
And it needs to be refreshed.
Okay.
And there's a lot of safety information in it for employees and mm-hmm. how to protect themselves from
I'm just thinking, if we had previously approved the expenditures of the choice funds, we should probably separate out the two items.
I hadn't encumbered them yet.
No, I realize you haven't encumbered them, but I just think as a committee we need to vote to take that money now from general fund surplus instead of school choice, just to document, if available. And that's one question. The second question is, the clocks were a very high priority when they were when we approved them, as was the window tinting was seen as a pretty significant security measure. I'm just wondering why it's taking a year to put it into effect.
Because I think we were waiting for school to be out.
Did we approve them last year during the summer or in fall?
January.
In January, okay. All right. I could make a motion as a first step to apply general fund surplus to the replacement of the clock system and tinting of the windows as previously approved, if available.
Second. Instead of from school choice.
Instead of from school choice.
Second, is that
second?
Okay. Any further discussion about that? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Can. And then the second one?
And then you had a list of three additional students.
So if you want to make a motion to allow administration to use available year-end funds for the priorities as outlined, and we can write them up and put them in the notes?
In the minutes.
In the minutes,
yeah.
Yes.
I think it'd be good down in the minutes.
Okay. Absolutely.
Keep track.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, all in favor? Aye. Okay. Anything else, Penny?
Nope, that's it, unless anybody has any questions.
Okay, so. Thank you much. All right, moving on to public comment. Public comment.
My name is Tracy Westover. I wanted to speak to you this evening about concerns regarding, again, communication. At the end of May, May 30th, I believe it was, my fifth grade son came home and told me that the fifth and sixth grades were no longer going to be switching classes and that some teachers would be moving up or down. My concern about this is multifaceted because child came home with the information before there was any information put out to the parents. There's a group of parents on Facebook together. I raised the question as to whether anybody had heard this, and there was a huge outpouring of concern from the parents. Ms. Heil sent an email on May 31st regarding because information had been, quote, trickling out, and indicated that this was a teacher-driven decision that had been discussed for a long period of time, and it was pretty much due to the fact that there's a current sixth grade group of students who are behaviorally challenging. My understanding is now that there are two behavior specialists on staff, and my thought is that if this particular sixth grade group is the challenging group, they're going to be moving to Frontier. And now a fifth grade group of students who's been used to switching classes and meeting new teachers and working with different teaching styles and having movement in their day is now going to be self-contained the year prior to going to Frontier, where they will all have to switch for every class, work with different teaching styles, and be really confused. As a middle school educator myself, watching kids come in from a K through 6 building into 7th grade, we spent at least the first 2 months acclimating them to what it's like to be a middle schooler. And if that work can be supported in elementary school, it's going to make a much easier transition for our students. My argument would be that if the school felt that this was necessary, information should first of all have been given out to the parents a long time ago. Parents should have had an opportunity to voice their opinions and concerns, be involved with the discussion, be involved with the research around the decision, and perhaps start it with the current 4th grade class who is not used to switching for classes, as the current 5th grade group is. Because this is not just going to impact the current students, it's going to obviously impact anybody who comes to this building in the future. I believe it's been 14 years since this practice has been in place of switching classes for 5th and 6th grade. My understanding is that teachers were told that they were going to move either up or down a level. They weren't given an option to make that decision or to have a conversation about it. I feel that Ms. Heil had indicated that she was going to put the information out in a newsletter, which is sent home digitally, and I feel that that's not fair because perhaps there are families within our district that don't have access to technology and wouldn't have access to the information. I'm really concerned that this seems to be a very quick decision, and I think it speaks to the louder and more obvious problem that in this building there is so much, I don't even know the word, dissension. I think teachers are unhappy. You are losing people. Veteran seasoned, amazing educators at an alarming rate. And I really, really think that things need to be looked at. We are thrilled to be part of this community. But looking around when you come in this room, teachers are so unhappy and they're looking over their shoulders all the time. And they're not heard, they don't have a voice. They're at times almost bullied into what they are told they're going to do. And I'm just really, it's very sad to me. I think that the fact that there's no school council is concerning. There's been zero school council meetings this year, which is a violation of educational law. Parents have not had the ability to voice their concerns, share their thoughts, and have an open discussion about how things are going to go on in the school. Teachers have been just disappearing, and while no parent expects specific information as to why teachers are leaving, it would be nice to be told, hey, parents, there's a new music teacher, Mr. I don't even know his name because we haven't been introduced to him. Please welcome him to our building. My understanding is that teachers haven't even been introduced to this poor man. So I just really think that the communication needs a lot of work, and I'm very concerned about what it's going to mean for our students, particularly the current 5th grade class. And I really hope that you take some time to think about that and take steps to help us make it better, because this is a community school and we all need to be involved to help our children. Thank you.
Anyone else?
I'm just gonna say the same thing I've been saying. The communication is still horrible. It really is, and again, it goes not to parents, and I'm also seeing it in the after school program, that those fine ladies over there don't get communication from the administrators here, and it trickles into every facet, I believe, and I've now seen even teachers are saying that they are afraid to even speak up here because of the retaliation. So it's really, you know, again, I stand up and I say the same thing over again, but it really is a critical mass here. We have good teachers leaving, and I do believe that people are going to end up going school choice and leaving also, which I've been told that this is a great school. So it needs to be, attention needs to be there. It needs to be looked at.
My name is Denise Boudreau, and I was really debating whether or not I wanted to stand up here and say anything. I've been involved with the school since 2000, when my now 22-year-old came here for preschool. It's always been a fantastic school. However, I now have my daughter that's in fourth grade, and a About 5 years ago, I started as a sub, and then I became the crossing guard. And I have worked here just completely as a sub in Deerfield since I became the crossing guard about 4 years ago, and worked almost every single day. I was on many teachers' preferred sub lists, and I had teachers coming up to me in the hallway asking me to sub for them or for their IA. And there was never any problem. The beginning of this year, a parent went to a meeting with the administration and the school and the superintendent, and they were told that she got all of her information from me about bullying and lack of communication, which was totally untrue. Then I had an incident with another sub where there was inappropriate language being used, and I told my daughter when he was subbing in that classroom that if there was a problem, that she should go and tell somebody. Well, she decided to say something to the other kids in the classroom. So the end of that was that I was no longer allowed to sub in the office, which I had subbed in as the secretary for, in the past 2 years, 55 times. When
can I interrupt you for a second? Is this an individual thing involving just you and your situation in school?
No, it's regarding of the bullying, the lack of communication, okay, and the behavior issues. When I spoke to Dr. Carey, she told me that she was told I was a fantastic sub, there was no problem, that I could work any place in the school other than the office. So I continued working. Then, and this is the part about the behavior problem, I had a second grade student in music that was upset, and he started throwing chairs at other kids. And I ended up getting let go as a sub for...
Denise, again, I guess what I'm trying to say is, if this is your own individual kind of employment situation, it's sort of inappropriate for you to... Because we're not going to get involved in anybody's
It's not.
It seems to be your own complaints about...
The behavior...
The behavior of who?
The behavior of the student.
Right, but we're not here to talk about individual students. It's the school committee. We have no purview over... It's not our place to get involved in individual students' discipline or problem.
I was told that I was probably going to be shut down for speaking about this.
Well, it's not a question of being shut down. It's just a question of it's not really appropriate for...
Well, what is the forum? I've called Dr. Carey. She won't return my calls. She doesn't return my emails. What is the forum?
If
there is a problem in the school with the children with behavior problems, that somebody gets fired because another sub was, and with the permission of the school committee, of the administration, that he was bribed.
Well, I'm saying it sounds like an employer-employee situation, which is really not our, it's not our area to deal with that. So whatever chain of command through, whether it's a grievance, or whether it's going up to, you know, vice principal, principal, superintendent, I think that's the appropriate avenue, but it's not, we're not going to get involved in anybody's individual disciplinary situation,
it
whether it's a teacher or a
student.
We're certainly not going
to
get involved in individual
cheers.
We're not, we can't.
And the behavior is just, it's like, no, they didn't fill out an incident report. And so you have an administration that agrees that a child should be bribed out of the room with a pencil rather than punishing the behavior.
Okay. Thank you. Does anybody else have any public comments? There was, and again, I had some
response. Did I interrupt you?
Not at all.
Okay. So my name is Emily Whitney, and I have two boys here. One's in fifth grade and one's in third grade. I think it's a fantastic school. My son graduated from here last year, I appreciate all of the time you all put in to volunteering your time to make make this the great place that it is. But that being said, I am concerned about the changes for sixth grade, and I emailed each of you this week over the weekend, so you're aware of my concerns. And from the responses that I got, I feel like this decision to switch to a self-contained classroom is already set in stone. Tracy's already said this, but I feel like this decision should have been made with parent input and school committee input. And I would love for you to reconsider going back to the departmentalized model where the students will switch classes for sixth grade. I feel like it's one of the strengths of Deerfield Elementary School that our kids get to do this. And I think that it really prepares them for middle school, whether they go to Frontier or any other school. Switching classes and having different teachers is a benefit to them. And I believe that you're doing a disservice to our students by eliminating it. Thank you for your time. I really hope to be more involved going forward with all of this, and I look forward to the discussion tonight.
Thanks. Anybody else on this sixth grade issue before we get us? I understand that. Not completely.
No, I didn't know this other one.
Yeah.
Hi, my name's Andy Bedell. I have three students here, a fourth coming in the fall. My concern is more about the communication. I'm not happy about the switch per se, but at the last school committee meeting, I know communication was brought up as a concern. And to have it continue immediately after, you know, left me with the question, how do we make change in that? You know, how do parents get that communication out there? It's really hard because not only is it trickling out through kids, it's often wrong. And so you have upset parents because their kids know more about it than they do, but you can't walk them back from their concerns because the information is shared with 10, 11 year olds prior to being shared with parents. So when they come home and they're upset, we have no place to turn. And I just wonder how we can change that.
Well, my initial thoughts on that, just because while you're talking, I'm thinking about it. I don't know why kids here would be getting information, before parents, and they shouldn't be. And I don't know whether that's an issue in the school with faculty or other administrators talking with kids, or somehow. You know, teachers who have kids. I mean, that's just a no-no across the board, and I don't know how that's happening, but it doesn't make any sense to me that obviously a decision that may be being discussed is somehow coming to you through a child. So how it got there in the first place is a problem. But it's, the real communication concern that I think I have is when a decision is made, how is it getting out to parents appropriately? So things like rumors and information, that's just an unfortunate dynamic, which I don't know how kids are hearing about it, but if it's wrong, as you say, it's just unfortunate because, as you say, it stirs the pot and it's wrong and it's not helpful.
Well, to me, so it speaks to the, I don't have any stories or contacts that are telling me that teachers are unhappy. Sure. But as an educator myself, you start to talk about things that bother you, often inappropriately, because you're not feeling heard. Yeah. You know, the good things you kind of keep to yourself. It's when things bother you, it's, I mean, a way of life. Yeah. They kind of make their way out. Yeah. And it definitely speaks to the dissension, or I'm not sure what the words the other parents have used, but it makes me feel like that is probably true because things keep kind of just sliding out.
Yeah. I think also communication is, there's a general problem nowadays. I'm not saying offending anybody here, but it just, I think we have so many methods of communication, and as somebody just mentioned, we have concerns about some parents who don't, you know, maybe aren't on an email blast, and so we have sort of some emails, some things are going out electronically, some things are going out by paper, and I mean, it's a discussion that you guys should be having all the time because we need to have better communication, but it also is tricky. Like, I don't know that you're ever going to have one method until people are comfortable saying, get it on an email account, or go back to paper to make it consistent. But I think everybody hears you. I hope the administration is hearing that this issue of communication between, you know, and individual teachers, by the way, we have problems. I can't remember what I saw. Maybe it was at Frontier. People are also upset with individual teachers, you know, not double checking at the beginning of the year to make sure all their emails are, you know, that they're asking parents to write back, confirm that this is your email address, because they realized they weren't getting emails for 6 months or something. So I'm just saying the communication is, you know, top to bottom. Everybody can do better, but I hear that there's a general problem that people need to work on. I don't know if anyone has another thought about communication up here, but
I do. Appreciate your comment. I second all of that. We really need to do a better job of communicating major changes earlier, and bringing community along with us when we're making a big change, because this is a large change, and it certainly affects a lot of families and their plans for where they want their children to be, where they want their children to be, and how they want them educated. But on such a major issue as this, and even small issues, we've got to do a better job, as I said last meeting, of bringing the community along with us and getting out ahead of a major change to make sure everybody has up-to-date current information, you know, such as this area, talking with, you know, I know Louise is here today to maybe give some substance to why this decision was made, so that people feel a little bit more comfortable about it. Mm-hmm.
And I think you have to remember, if a decision gets out somehow before it's able to be communicated to everybody, that's not necessarily the fault of the person who should be communicating it to everybody.
Correct.
You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
No, absolutely. That's absolutely true.
Information is unfortunately being dispersed by people
who
shouldn't.
It is a pattern.
The pattern's what's concerned.
It's a pattern, and you just said yourself, well, I hope.
Hope what?
How about we stop hoping that it will get better and actually do something?
Well, I agree. I think I just expressed that I hope the administration is working on this.
Well, we can hope, and what are concrete steps that we can take to make sure that that happens?
Well, hopefully they'll work on that. I mean, the other thing is, as a parent, don't forget that, like, there is so much information, and I'm switching schools again, sorry, but the information that's available if you go on the Frontier website is so much more than I ever get on my, you need to be proactive.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying the elementary school is the same, but I'm just saying, I bet there are tons of parents that say, well, I don't know what's going on at Frontier. If you go and look on the website, you can know exactly what's going on first thing in the morning, what the whole school announcement
is. This is not relevant.
I know it's different here, but I'm saying, I think we all are to be a part of it. Maybe a task force needs to be set up to talk more about communication, because it's obviously an issue, but we're not going to, again, it's not going to come from on high, right? You wouldn't want that for us to suddenly decide how it's going to be. So I would hope that some group is put together, parents, administration.
This is being taken seriously.
That's you're entitled to feel that way.
I feel that you're being very condescending.
I certainly don't mean to be.
Could I say something, David? Maybe you could review for the audience exactly what our job is. Because our job is not in the day-to-day management of the school.
Yeah.
So maybe you could outline what the job of the school committee is.
Well, I mean, I would hope that you know that our job is not day-to-day management, right? But obviously, if concerns like this are being brought to us, I think it is our job to put some influence on administration, which I think I am trying to express tonight, should be done, and should be done, more.
But I think that's what's happening. This is why it's coming here, is that we're not being heard by the administration.
Yeah.
I think that people don't answer emails, don't answer phone calls, and that's why you're getting that. That's why people are here, is because we're not.
And
that,
people
that
don't know where to go
down
to help solve that problem. I don't.
First of all, this is all, first we started with the fifth and sixth grade issues that we're talking about. So, it's hard.
May I speak to that? Two children here. The example that I would like to give is not at all to do with fifth and sixth grade, but it is related to communication. I do think that communication needs to be distinct from enfranchisement, which parents don't have in this community anymore with the school. Parents need to have involvement in these decisions. But this example has nothing to do with fifth and sixth grade. I'm concerned about the lack of understanding of the human component of education here. There are students who are the number one priority, there are staff that need to be supported to be able to support those students, and there's parents who need to also be brought into this process. It's like there's three groups that I don't feel are being included. The music teacher, current music teacher, was not introduced at the spring concert that I attended last week. This decision is not a new decision. The feeling in the room that I felt was very different than past concerts. And there was no mention of like the fact that this person had to come in and start mid-year. It's a really hard thing for a teacher to come in with a new group of students who don't have a teacher that they have a relationship with. I don't want to talk about why that other teacher is not here. I want to say that those kids deserve to be recognized. It was the last concert of the sixth grade that's leaving. My own kids are looking forward to the end of the year when they get to sing a goodbye song to the sixth grade. I'm not sure that's going to happen. There's a lot of human components that are being lost. I couldn't believe that there was no acknowledgement and reward to the students for their hard work with a new teacher and for that teacher. I still don't know that teacher's name. It's my child said it starts with a T. That's all I know. I'm sorry, but it makes me a little concerned when you say, like, there's sort of an insinuation that faculty might be talking about things. I think that there's a lot of blame game happening, and it's not about blaming anybody. I think right now we need to say, what's the solution?
Right. The solution is for everybody to be involved.
There's no agency. There's no way for people to get involved. And I hear you, like, you have a different role. Where are we to go?
Hi, my name is Louise Law. I'm the curriculum director for the district for the four elementary schools. And first, I want to thank you for coming and airing what your concerns are. It is important that as a district and as a school, we do a better job of communicating. And I'm hearing you, and I really do appreciate that. It is true, we need to make relationships to make schools a successful place. And if parents aren't feeling included, we need to do a better job of that, absolutely. I work in four different schools, so I spend some time. I did spend 1 year as the principal here 6 years ago, and my own children went to school here. I think it is and still is a wonderful school with committed faculty. I do want to put a slightly different lens on the shift with the fifth and sixth grade, and I did read the communication that went out, and I agree it could have been done better and more inclusively. The lens that I'm going to give you is the lens of seeing classrooms across the district and sixth and fifth grades across the district. When we originally had the differentiated class changing, the curriculum was very different back 14 years ago. Now we have a kind of curriculum where kids need to spend time focusing. What has shifted is the world around us doesn't give us time to breathe and focus the way we need to really learn. What I've seen in the shift in curriculum is we need more time for kids to focus on the literacy that we're doing. They had to get up and move in the middle in this year, in sixth grade, of writing, in the middle of reading. There wasn't the time that we need to give the depth that I'm seeing in other sixth grades right now. So one of the reasons for the shift is to allow that flexibility. Yes, if they practice when they go to seventh grade, it's less of a shift, but our other three schools, the kids adjust just fine. Specifically spoken to the curriculum director and the principal over at Frontier and said, is there any difference? No. There's no difference between when Deerfield kids get there and Waitley and Sunderland and Conway as far as adjusting. But I do see more time for kids. I mean, it's sort of their last year to have the opportunity to not rush, rush, rush. Rush and change, rush and switch, rush and switch. And I see that as a really positive thing. We rush kids all the time. I, as a mother, was always saying, get in the van, get in the van. So I'm hoping that you can understand that this shift was made for positive reasons, to give kids more time to think, to go more in depth, and to experience their final year of really being in elementary school. So that was a big part of the reason for looking at that shift. We saw that the kind of curriculum we're asking teachers to teach now is challenging in sixth grade with the kind of shifting we were doing. So that was a part of the conversation and a part of the decision. But you're right, the communication needs to be strengthened, and I appreciate your courage to come out and state that publicly, and we will work on it. I'm in four different schools, but I know I'm going to be doing a lot of thinking about how, as a district, we can do a better job of communicating. What are the shifts in curriculum? What are we asking, demanding young children to do now under the all of the different curriculum standards that we have? So I just wanted to address that, and again, thank you for letting us know, quite honestly, what your concerns are.
My name is David Goodrow. I have a son in third grade and in fifth grade. And my question is more about the communication, the email that was sent home explaining this change. And to me, it sounded as though, which was said earlier, sixth grade is undisciplined and out of control, and they're graduating. So that would be one reason for the change, is what it sounded like. And the second reason for the change in the letter I read was that the teachers are going to be moved for the same reason. Like the sixth grade, it sounded as though the sixth grade teachers can't handle discipline problems, and so they're going to change that as well. So it seems like they're doing two things to address a discipline problem that has nothing to do with the curriculum side of things. So I think it's a confusing bit of information that we were given. So maybe if you had sent the letter, it might have been clearer.
I agree. The way that this shift was communicated could have been better. And we will do it better. We will rephrase it and talk about the positives for students that will be coming from having more of that time, more flexibility, you know, to say, if you're working on a math or a writing project, just because it's 10:05 doesn't mean you have to change. You do in middle school, but here's our last opportunity to give kids that time. So I appreciate hearing how that communication was received, and I think we can do better than that. So thank you. I appreciate that.
I have one question for Louise.
Yes.
In this change, did you see statistics across the district that showed that test scores were any better? I was doing some research on, departmentalized or self-attainment, plateauing, they call it. And there was, it was up in the air whether which process was better than the other. And there was a lot of studies out there on it. I didn't, in a short time, I didn't read all of them. But I was curious, are you seeing different test scores in different grades across the district that would lead us to want to move back to a compartmentalized?
One of the challenges of comparing is we're comparing different kids in different settings and different, so.
Sure.
But I will say the growth in academics is an area we do look at. So where kids come in and then how much they grow from point A to point B. Yeah. And there is growth data that suggests that this is a good shift. In our district. Yes.
Was there a school therapist or a psychologist in this group?
In the conversation?
Yeah.
Was there? I think there were many. I was involved in some of the conversation. There were many, many conversations. So maybe Tina could speak to that.
In two of the conversations that I were in, there was a school adjustment counselor and a psychologist.
And those are in the minutes.
No, so I wasn't involved in all of the meetings. There was two mini meetings that I was involved in, and we did not take minutes. I'm looking at.
It's like there might have been a process that should be documented, but that's another issue.
Agreed.
The reason I bring up the school psychologist is because
my daughter's in fifth grade, and she's going into six. And so I talked with her therapist. She goes to a therapist because we adopted her 4 years ago. She had a lot of trauma. And so she's not one of the children with discipline problems, but she is a child that is full of anxiety, and change is very difficult. And I don't mean change like changing classrooms, those types of things. So I think it's kind of going backwards for kids that have a lot of anxiety to have them changing and go to a year of not changing and then back to where, inevitably where they're going to be for the next 5 to however many years. I think that's going to bring up a lot of anxiety for children. I also know from the therapist that the changing, if the time management aspect is handled correctly, can be a reset time for kids, and kids should have that as part of their day for moving from one class to the next. We've taught Olivia personally how to reset, so she knows how to do that, but I believe it's something, one, I think that the transition from class to class, teachers rush, rush, rush. I think that's administratively a time management issue. I think time management is something that our children should be taught, and I think that our administration should be good at that and helping our children with that. I forgot my second point. Sorry. But anyways, that's my thoughts on that. And I would, my last question is this set in stone, or is there an opportunity for this to be flipped and changed back?
I think there's going to be a change. And I want to also support something that Ms. Rain said is school committees make policy in Massachusetts under education reform. They don't make procedure. So school committee's job is to look at the law and make policy. Policy doesn't tell the school how to operate. So procedures are up to the local administration. So, and it is within the purview of a principal to move teachers to make some of those decisions. I will say this, I agree the communication could be better. What I will say is a lot of thought and a lot of conversation and weighing some of the cons and the pros was put into this decision. It wasn't made on the fly. So I think that needs to be communicated better. So, and there were many people involved in thinking about this. Yes.
Were any parents?
No.
My blood is boiling, so I'm going to ramble on. But my child's part of NACOS. And to find out things through them or with the communication that was, you know, blamatory on the bad behavior of some of the students was really disheartening and upsetting. And part of me was like, whatever, I'm out. This is my third child, my last one. I'm done in sixth grade. But the educator part of me was like, I love these other kids, and I know some of them really well, and I love them, and I don't want this to be what happens. I don't want the teachers to get blamed because all three are fantastic. And I think that the switching has made a huge difference. And my daughter, actually in eighth grade now, came home in seventh grade and said it made a difference. The other kids who came from the other schools had more trouble. They were unable to get a friend as much. They had trouble going around. And so when my sixth grader came home and said, this is not going to happen anymore, she was concerned not about herself and the fact that they weren't going to be switching for the rest of the year, but concerned about every other kid coming up through DES who wasn't going to have the same opportunity she and her sister had. And I think that's great for her, but really sucky, sorry, for everybody else that that's what's going to happen. And the way that we're finding out about things that are impacting my child's education are through these, first of all, through them. And back to the music teacher too, like there's this advanced chorus thing that happens in the morning where we drop our kids off at 8 o'clock in the morning and they go into a school with one teacher. And we weren't introduced to this teacher, but I'm supposed to let my daughter just go ahead in. I walked in with her the first time because I don't know this person. I'm not just gonna let her go with somebody I don't know. I know you do background checks, but that kind of stuff, that communication, things that I think just really felt
inappropriate all this year, and I feel like even though my kids are out of here, I can't be silent, and it's really important that we make sure that there's something happening now and that this isn't happening anymore.
Thank you. This is a theme. It's very clear. And I appreciate your, I know it's hard, and I appreciate your sharing this. I really do. And it's not falling on deaf ears. I want you all to know that. So thank you for showing up and sharing your emotional response to this. It's a big lesson for us as a school. So thank you.
Louise.
Yes.
If I may, two questions. One, who was part of all the conversations? Because I sit here and I see the curriculum coordinator and assistant principal, they weren't part of all the conversations. That seems kind of out of whack to me, that such instrumental people in decision making weren't part of all the conversations. So that's my first question. My second question is, I know the school reached out to parents and said, if you want input on who your child has as a teacher, moving ahead, there was a deadline. That deadline's passed. At the time, I'm sure many parents were like, well, they're going to have all three, right. You know?
That's
so
that
doesn't really matter. Now, that's a huge difference.
Sure.
You know, and I mean, we're sitting here, it's June 7th, I believe. There's not a lot of time for people to do legwork to figure out, like, who is right for my child. You know, there's a lot of conversations that need to take place. Especially if you have a child who has needs, special needs, you know, and those kids are just going to get stuck somewhere. It feels like, you know, because, I mean, June 26th, people are ready to be on summer break, you know, and you're not going to have the access. People are going to be going away so that you're not even going to be able to have those conversations to set your child up for the most success.
That's a really good point and something that we should revisit.
We can revisit parent input. Yeah. There is a big team for placement. You know, teachers have a lot of...
No, certainly.
Yeah.
And I know there's...
But we can revisit.
And it's done very caringly, and I totally get that. And I have been very pleased with the process as they go along. But, you know, this is going to be two groups of kids, classes worth of children, who... Parents may have thought, like I did, that, well, they're going to have everybody, you know, and that's a selling point, you know, because when you get that letter, August, that says you're going to have whoever you have. I mean, I've certainly had the conversation with my own children. It's not that bad. Don't worry, you know, like, it's going to be great, you know, because it is about who they're with in terms of their peers, but it is also about who their teachers are. And I know with... going into sixth grade, it's a special grade, and you see it in the talent show, at the respect all the students have for the teachers in that grade, and to think now that kids have been watching the sixth form, adoration, public adoration for that group of teachers up on stage, and to now know that, for them to come home and be like, oh, I can't have one of those teachers. It's not even a possibility. That's huge on that human aspect that was brought up earlier.
Especially if you have sons, because I have two sons that went to the school and graduated and moved on. I have a 22-year-old and a 26-year-old. So they were in the school during the years of Doug Tierney. And there was a lot of male role models, which was great. There is not a lot of male role models in the school currently. And I think that... my daughter has a lot of friends that are boys, and I know that they themselves were really looking forward to those male mentors their sixth year, their last year before they go on to Frontier. And I think it's kind of like, it feels very unfair and like a bomb has been dropped, sort of, and I think it's going to be very disheartening to those children. And very difficult for them.
Hi, I'm the superintendent. First of all, again, I repeat what Louise says. I really want to thank you all for coming. And I agree entirely with Louise. I was not involved in any of the meetings. In fact, I think you parents knew about it before I did.
That's crazy.
However, This was a decision that was school-based with central office. Louise was the one that, the central office with the principal and the assistant principal. But I support it because they made such a great, they made such a reasonable and great case for it. It is really child-centered, the decision. It's the best decision for students. And I really have to tell you that I agree with you. The information is somehow getting out there. When children are coming home with information that hasn't even come, the decision hasn't even been made final and come to my desk yet, and students are going home telling their parents, that is concerning to me. And so I really feel badly about that. And I can understand how you would feel. Your kids are coming home telling you things, and I just don't know where they're getting it. And unfortunately, what had happened and the way it was presented definitely was wrong. And it is a learning process, and we will take the time and the energy to communicate in a different way, to communicate more. I do know that they have the newsletter, they have the teacher, the BST team. There's so many different teams, but I think the PTA, I'm not sure how many teachers go to PTA, but I know the administrators are at the PTA meetings all the time. But I think the school council might be the right thing if we all have norms and we all behave. Also, too,
I'm sorry, can you just say a little bit more about what do you mean by we all behave?
Well, when we follow norms, so that we're not, you know, we're not like saying we're using words that are positive. So we're not saying we don't, you know, we it would help us if you communicated better. It bothers me when my children come home and tell me things. Could you find a way to help me know sooner? That kind of information.
And then one other thing, you said something about the school council.
I think
can
that's...
You, can you talk a little bit more about that? Because I actually was at a barbecue this past weekend, and I thought, oh, that's something I'd like to join, I'd like to be a part of. Uh-huh. And then I realized, or was actually informed, that we didn't have any school council meetings this year. And I thought that that was something that was supposed to happen.
There were two people that I identified to administration, and no school council meeting was ever called.
So this is good information.
I was one of those people.
So this is definitely something we're going to rectify. There will be school councils. There will be school council meetings, and we will have them. And
why do you think happened that those didn't take place? Because I'm just confused by how that could slip a whole year.
I don't know. And
isn't that something that is said to happen by law?
Yes. The principal's not here, and I don't know if they were, I don't know.
I can say that when I volunteered to be on the school council, I participated in the PTA, thinking that that was my way to get into the community and support my school and the staff and kids. I realized a lot of the things I was asking were more school council oriented. And not school committee oriented. I apologize that this feels like maybe a hassle in a way because we don't have another forum. And so I inquired of Ms. Kyle at a PTA meeting in September and said, I realize I really should be on school council. I'd like to be on what's happening with school council. And she told me that she hadn't been able to have one because parents weren't interested and hadn't come. And I said, that's too bad because it's against the law not to have one. And I'd be willing to come because I want the school to be supported. I want parents to have a forum. So I did, you know, speak with the PTA. I was one of the people that was appointed. We haven't had any meetings.
And that's wonderful. I can tell you that we will have a school council. I can guarantee it. I don't know what happened this year, and I'm not sure. But we will rectify that, and that's what we can tell you. Moving forward, we will rectify that. And I think perhaps having a school council would help parents feel a little bit better. But having said that, I need to temper it with a lot of decisions are made. We refer to different positions and someone else coming in and working with kids and so, you know, someone just leaving. These are personnel decisions. And we're bound by law, and I follow this law for sure. We cannot talk about personnel issues.
So you can't introduce a new teacher?
Nobody's asking you to do that.
But the fact that someone left, I don't know if the new, I don't know. I really was at that concert and I heard the principal introduce him. I don't know.
Just came either today or yesterday about.
I saw something recently.
There was a letter that came today. About the change.
So, and we couldn't, you know, at the time of the concert, that person is a long-term sub, not officially. So we have to be, you know, we have to follow certain laws. So we do want to just close it up. We really want to communicate better. I will work closer. I need you to tell me. I do answer all my emails. If they come to me and they're saying the same thing over and over again, if I'm answering them, and then there's some that you just, but parents email me all the time and I meet with them and I talk with them. I do need to tell you that we will have a school council. I will encourage this team to work harder, to communicate in a more positive way, and to let you know the information as we know it. And I am a little concerned that kids are coming home with information.
I'm sorry, I don't want communication. I want participation. I want collaboration. I want the processes to be democratic and transparent.
I hear what you're saying. At some point in time, I mean, we sit on the school committee. It's been pointed out tonight. We deal with, you know, policies and hand down the procedures and the running of the schools to the administrators and the professionals that are hired to do that. We do want to have parent participation, I can speak for myself and say that we expect that through the mechanisms that are provided, there should be room for parent participation. But at a point in time, we pay professionals to make decisions. We pay professionals who have been trained to teach students to make decisions. And when they make those decisions, sometimes they aren't what everyone agrees with. I understand the frustration here tonight, and it's certainly palpable. And it's concerning to me to hear a lot of things. We did talk about communication a month ago. We've talked about communication a few times during the year. I've received more communication in the last 3 weeks on issues that are going on in DES than I had been getting as a school committee member in quite some time. I don't expect to be involved in day-to-day operational decisions. It's not what I'm elected to do. I'm elected to deal with policy, hire a superintendent, hire a principal, and set the budget. So
I just think that folks, communication is a piece.
I have the floor, ma'am.
Excuse me.
I'm not done talking just yet. We've been very patient in listening to everyone tonight, and we're hearing what's being said. And I can only speak for myself. I can say there's a definite frustration. I can't speak to totally where it comes from, but there's a lot going on in this school. I've been involved with the school for over 30 years, and I hear the same theme every year. So this is not new. Yes, you can say what you want, but I can, the Doug Tierney years, right on up through the present years, there's been constant turmoil in this school. I hear every year that morale is low, that faculty is leaving, et cetera, and yet school choice remains strong at the school. This is a highly desirable school. I'm proud of this school. I think most everyone in this room is proud of this school. There is a frustration right now with communication and other issues that we can get through and solve, but we can't do it here in the school committee meeting. It needs to happen and allow the administration to find a way to do it. I'm happy to participate in the task force as a school committee member to talk about communication issues, but parents don't make decisions regarding the school's operations. Teachers and the professionals that are hired to run the school make those decisions. Parents can have input, they can express concerns, but ultimately, I rely on the people with the experience to provide us with the information that we need to make the decisions we have to. So.
You addressed kind of the morale, and you said that for a year in the past, because of 30 years or so, you've noticed like people expressing it. I have been coming to the school every single day to either drop off my child or pick up my child from school. And when we first started in kindergarten, the teachers were a lot happier. I am a professional observer. I'm a therapist, and so it's my job to do that and witness and observe and watch these behaviors. In this school, over the past 4 years, the morale, the joy in the teachers is going down. And people are leaving because of that. And that needs to be addressed. And the kids know this. My daughter in first grade noticed how her teacher was struggling. And she had the greatest teacher. And so, you might say that over the past 30 years, you see that people complain about it all the time. I come here every single day.
Look at the turnover rate over the past 2 years compared to what you've been to for 30 years.
We're going to move on, but thanks for all the input. So, we need to move on to our student activity count. Further discussion. Who's taking the oral with that policy?
So, that was brought to you by Janine and myself, and we had discussions last month how we had received training, and this was partially a request from the PTA because they have sort of been banking our money for us, and we've been working with the town treasurer, Barb Hancock. And this is allowed by law, Mass General law, to establish this revolving account. And we would just like an official vote for us to continue working with the treasurer to get this going for July 1st.
Okay. I think you handed out the policy or description of it in the last meeting.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Do you remember the amount we were setting for that revolving account?
$10,000.
Okay. Good. And that's a motion to approve that?
I would make a motion to approve the student activity accounts as set forth in the policy.
Okay. Second. Second, John. Any questions or further discussion about it? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. So moved. And then it says further discussion on non-union salary recommendations.
I just wanted to bring you to note, we did pass out a chart, and I forgot to, there was one adjustment on that chart, and I should have brought you new charts tonight, and I totally dropped the ball on that. Our out-of-school time director came to Dr. Carey and I and requested that we do a 1% increase for the staff. We have had lower than normal enrollments in our program, and we've had some higher costs that we've had to incur. And last year, the school time program, as did some of our other lower level paid staff, received more than a 2% increase because we had to adjust them for the increase to the minimum wage going to $11 in January. So we are, for the first time in many, many years, raising the tuition in the out-of-school time program, and she would like to do a one-year freeze at 1%, just so we can see how the financials will fall out with the increased tuition.
So was that on our last chart that we voted on?
Yes.
So we're voting to
to reduce the average school time from a 2% to a 1%.
Okay. And that's because of the self-contained budget that is being...
Correct. It's run by...
Worried it wouldn't be...
By its revenues.
Yeah. Okay.
Can I ask for those that are going to be affected? Are they aware of this?
I do believe that the school director, well, no one's aware of anything until you vote something, and then everybody gets a letter saying what you voted. So at this time, I would say no, they're probably not aware, just like anyone else on that list is not aware of what we put forward to you. Once they're all approved by the five school committees, well, we do each individual school as the school committee votes, and then administration gets it after all five school committees vote. We get a letter notifying us what you voted and what our raises will be.
Do folks have an expectation of a raise? Or, yeah.
Well, they are getting a raise.
You're getting a raise, just a 1% instead of 2%. Sorry, jump into 2%.
Correct.
Right. Mm-hmm. But my question, I guess, was did you just present that? Okay, we didn't vote last time. You just gave us the list, and then you forgot to give us the list.
I forgot to update the list and bring it to you.
And I asked, and I asked for some information relative to standing of salaries in relation to what has occurred in the classification schedule at the town.
Mm-hmm. And I did send that out.
She provided that back out to us.
Are they also moving steps every year as well? So they're moving a step plus they're getting a 1%.
And that was all adjusted last year because some people in the transition of the previous out-of-school time director, when we were going over budgets with the new OST, some people were on step, some people were not step. So it was sort of random. So we not only had to make, they got an adjustment because of the minimum wage going up, well then they got on a step. So last year, some of them probably received 3.5%, maybe 4%.
Right.
And our wages are very competitive for this after school and before school time program.
Thank you. So we're looking, I think, for a motion to approve the non-union salary recommendations as presented.
Well, I would have to send you a new presentation for you.
But the only change is what you just mentioned.
Correct.
For that
and I'm going to email 1%. Them to you right now.
Okay. But we're not meeting it.
Correct. So you could say as presented with the exception that out of school time program would receive 1% instead of 2%.
Yes. Okay.
So a motion to, who started the motion?
I did?
I thought you were going to. A motion to approve the wage schedule for non-professional staff.
Non-union
staff as presented with the exception of the out-of-school time program, which would be reduced as recommended.
Which would receive a 1% increase.
1% increase.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you. And I am emailing this to you as we speak.
Thank you. Lynn, it's your presentation, I think.
So, in your packet, you received the Student Transportation Policy, EEA. Number 9 on this policy states, grades K to 3 students will not be released from the vehicle, meaning the bus, unless a parent, guardian, or designated caregiver is present. You can see where I've underlined or sibling in grade 4 or higher. If this occurs, the child will be returned to the school. What we'd like to do is request to add or sibling in grade 4 or higher. What happens is, K-3, we must see an adult, we must see a caregiver or a parent or somebody designated. When there's an older sibling, a lot of times the parents will let the older sibling bring the child into the house. We want to have it stated in our policy that it is okay for a child, if the parent agrees, the parent could be there, you know, if they want, but if the parent feels it's okay for the older sibling, the fifth or sixth grade student, to bring that child in third grade inside, then we would just like to have it in the policy so it's clear to everyone.
And how is that communicated? That the parents agree to that?
The parents, I believe they make their arrangements.
I don't think it's up to the parent. I mean, parents should know when the kids are coming home from school, so this is more of a safety thing, isn't it?
It's basically saying
we're not going to let you have your kid.
Unless we see a parent.
Yeah.
Right. If the parent says that they're with their older sibling, it's okay. We have a policy that will allow the parent the right to say that.
Our current practice is they do get off the bus if they have a sibling with them. Mm-hmm. In fourth grade. So we're having, because that is our practice, we need our policy to reflect that. So the current practice is if you're K to three, but you have a fourth grade, fifth grade, sixth grade sibling on the bus, we let you off without seeing a parent. That is our practice. And so
we have to hear that from a parent?
We had an issue. The reason we're bringing this forward is because we had a transportation issue in another district with a situation with separate households. And one household wanted one way and the other household wanted the other way. And we're telling household one, you can't tell household two what they can do. And so we had to go to the attorney. The attorney looked at the policy and he said, well, if your practice is to allow them off, then your policy should say that guardian, caregiver, or the sibling in grade four or older.
Okay. So we're not seeking parent permission for that older sibling to take them off. We're stating it unequivocally that a student in the third grade or less can get off with a sibling in the fourth grade or above.
And it is my understanding, Mr. Petivac, because I am one step removed from the transportation, but when I ask for transportation lists from all four elementaries, it is so detailed. So parents communicate with the schools.
Absolutely.
As to on day Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, drop my child here. Days Tuesday and Thursday, I will pick up my child. Mm-hmm. My child's going to the Oda school time program on such and such a date. Mm-hmm. It is my understanding that parents are in constant communication with our principals in our buildings as to how the children will be transported.
That's the way it works in my school, so I assume that would be the way it works here.
Okay. And you're not looking for a vote on this? You want us to do that in the fall?
Yes. It's just a discussion item.
Okay.
We'll talk
about
it in the fall.
Sure. Okay. Any questions? No? Okay. So you actually skipped ahead, but I didn't want to interrupt the flow. So if we can go back now to discussion items, review of the summary report on the superintendent's evaluation. Is that superintendent or? Yes. Can you do anything? Are you part of that committee? Or you want to?
Was I part of the committee? I wrote the summary.
There you go. Yeah. Or the committee.
I thank everyone. I want to, it's been my first year as superintendent, and I've learned a great deal. And I have 24 school committee members, and I've been working really hard to do everything that is expected and to do it at a really high standard. I had 7 goals. That's a little too many. I did meet them. Overall, I met them. The summary is 6 goals received a rating of met, with 1 goal receiving significant progress. That, of course, was moving central office to Frontier. And I appreciate that. Instructional leadership, I was rated as proficient based on the ratings in the comments. Instructional leader for the school year, leadership for the school year is proficient. I have to point out that my instructional leadership is only as good as my team, which is excellent. Sarah Mitchell and Louise Law, Kim McCarthy, these people are world class, and together that's what makes Union 38 and Frontier the exceptional district it is. And I appreciate their help and I appreciate the school committee's support. Management and operations proficient based on the ratings and the comments included. Dr. Carey's management and operation performance is proficient. Dr. Carey was consistently recognized for her work in completing the recommendations and eventual move to the central offices. Again, I had a lot of support. Patty Kavanaugh helps with the finances, and Bob Lesko with getting the movers involved, and it was pretty much seamless. We did it over the holiday break, and it went really well. But again, I had a lot of help. Family and community engagement. Dr. Carey's performance is proficient. Dr. Carey received proficient ratings in 3 of the 4 indicators with a needs improvement rating for communications. And I heard that very well tonight. And again, I appreciate everyone's input. Particularly Mary, who gave me many suggestions, and I appreciate that. Professional culture, Dr. Carey received proficient ratings, 5 of the 6 indicators, with a need for improvement in communications. So it's also important, shared vision and managing conflict indicators, and areas where Dr. Carey can improve is communication and sharing of the vision. And I have already started working on that. Again, I appreciate the input. As far as sharing our vision, we are working really hard putting together our administrator retreat, I call it administrator summit. We are going to be working on our strategic plan for continuous district improvement. We're going to roll it out. We're going to come up with a draft. These are the things we're going to be talking about at school councils. We're going to talk about curriculum. We're talking about assessment, which is a very important piece, and special ed. So these are the things we are going to be working on, and expect to hear a lot more about our strategic plan, our vision, our mission. This information will be all over the website. And the communication, I am going to really work on that. I have already started. I email a newsletter to the school committee every 2 weeks. I let them know the things I'm working on that behind the scenes. It's a very complex job running 5 school districts. And I do a superintendent's message that is out there online on the superintendent's page on the website every month, and it's something that we continue to strive to improve on, the communication. I appreciate everyone's support, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Tina, are you filling in today, or give us a report?
Yeah. So there's a lot of events going on. Year kind of draws to an end. We had Junior Olympics we just finished. Tom Scalzo and Sue Scott organized several events for the students. That Schmidt dedication is coming up. That's June 21st at 2. Wanted to remind everybody, student-led, teachers have been working hard on some presentations. You can almost feel the excitement in the building as it approaches. Everybody's looking forward to sharing their appreciation with that. Step Up Day is coming up Thursday. Principal Modesto and Assistant Principal Dredge have worked to put together a schedule so the students will move through those abbreviated rotation cycles, so they've learned the middle school. And K Visitation Night is tomorrow, where we'll be looking forward to welcoming our kindergarten students and families. Students will meet their teachers and visit their classrooms, and parents will learn about the program, so that's a fun night. And then there's so many great enriching activities that are happening. In first grade, as part of the mapping unit, Kathy Dorval's class, actually, is it just your class, Kathy, that's going on the field trip?
Yes, I'm sure we have a great first grade reading and some community mapping.
Something also. So they're using compasses, and they're going to be doing a walking adventure. They're going to be visiting Beth's free library and going up to the Tilton Library to learn about summer reading. So that's exciting. Second grade has, they're receiving their Flat Stanley Travelers back. They sent some Flat Stanleys out to different parts of the United States and other countries, and they're coming back with all sorts of stories, and some have bandages and video links so they can watch the video of their exploration. So it's a great way for kids to learn about places and cultures. The fifth grade students are looking forward to an upcoming, kind of funny to say, but an upcoming field trip to Bonnie's Island. They're working on a water filtration unit, and so this will be a good experience for them to hands-on experience. In sixth grade, I happened to walk into Mr. Hale's class today, and I thought that was a cool thing that I needed to share with the school committee. Like, islands are popping up everywhere. He's working with the students to encompass all of the geography standards, and they're and you can see Mike Anderson's differentiation work in the class, where students are able to show their knowledge through various projects. So some of the kids were working on Chromebooks, and there's clay models going on, some painting, and so they were all excited these days. But that's just a snapshot. There's so much going on in the building as the 2 weeks come to an end. I mean, we have Recognition Day coming up on June 22nd, so there's just so many events to look forward to.
Thank you. Always a fun, crazy time.
It is.
Let's see. I'm sorry, Dr. Carey, do you have a superintendent's report in addition to your other presentations?
Actually, you might. I think that.
Did you go cover it? Okay, but you've submitted one to us.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Anybody have any questions for Dr. Carey about her report?
Nope.
Okay. Anything on the collaborative?
I think in the interest of time, I've shared a summary of what happened right there.
Yeah. Thank you very much for that. Well, that was a good report.
If you receive any more paperwork like that, if you email or scan it or bring it to us, we'll make the copies for you.
Sure.
So that will save you that.
Thank you.
Great stuff, very interesting. Your Summer Academy, for any teachers in the audience, the Summer Academy at the Collaborative is amazing. And they're doing some really great stuff.
Okay. No other orders of business that I have, so I can move to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.